Now let's take care of this one. So what is the probability that the story is going to be empty at time t? Right? So we could again draw a diagram to see what's going on, right? So until time capital T, there will be customers coming in. Let's say this is the time when the first customer comes in. This is when the second customer comes in. And there will be, of course, well, if we just assume, let's say there are exactly n customers, there will be n customers coming in. So there will be Wn, the last. And for each one of them, we can attach these random variables, which denote the time they spend in the store, like this. Perhaps I can make this a little longer. And then on the same picture, we can also calculate actually exactly how many customers there will be in the store at time capital T. So the time when this, for example, the when does the first customer leave the store? It is? W1 plus Y1, right? Or if you just draw a 45 degree line, it just falls here, right? So this five piece equals like this. So this is when the first customer leaves, and this is when the second customer leaves, and this is when the end customer leaves. And according to this picture, you just look at all these lines which crosses this big line or the straight line, thick line at T. Actually, this says that the end customer was or is going to be in store at time T. Right? Right? Okay. So from this we can also write the number of, right? Maybe I should write the number of customers in the store at time capital T, right, equals, right, so what can I say about customer K, let's say, if he or she arrives before time T. So we will count him or her if his or her arrival time plus the time he or she spends in the store is at least as large as T, right? And we should just sum all these indicators from 1 to the number of arrivals until time T. For each arrival, we sum the arrival time and the time spent by that customer. If it is bigger than T, that means that customer is still in the store at time T. So we have this. Again, the indicator random variables help us a lot, right, to simplify things. And then, what can I do? In this problem, we are asked to calculate the probability that this sum equals what? What are we asked? We are asked to calculate the probability that this sum equals
zero,
right? So no customers. There should be no customers. Okay. Now, problem is difficult. It is difficult for one reason, namely that there are lots of random variables which are also connected somehow to each other, right? And we can first handle this by perhaps conditioning again on how many customers arrive until time t. Right? And let us do that and see whether that takes us anywhere. Alright, so this equals, now if I first condition on, this is the typical way of writing it, okay? So the expected value of the conditional expectations, and we know that conditional probability is in fact a conditional expectation, so this should not be a surprise for you. Okay, WK, YK greater than or equal to T, the indicator of this event equals zero, given the number of arrivals until time, this time we are looking at time capital T, right? And what is this? This is the same thing as writing, okay, for each possible value that number of customers arriving until time T can take, which is anything between 0 and plus infinity. This is the probability, first of all, the conditional probability that number of customers who are still in the store at time t equals 0, given the number of arrivals until time capital T equals n, times the probability that number of customers who arrive to the store till time t again equals n. We have that. We know what this is. Again, we have to worry about this conditional probability. When xt equals n, of course, we can replace this and write that. Now we would like to calculate this. Right? Let me continue from here. Maybe I should make it small. Okay. All right. Now, as before, right, conditioned on the number of arrivals over the interval from 0 to t, we know that the joint probability distribution of arrival times is similar to unconditional distribution of ordered statistics of the same number of independent, identically distributed, uniform random variables over the interval from 0 to capital T. Right? Too long to state, let's just write it again, right? So if there are n customers, so we pick n iid uniform random variables distributed over the interval from 0 to t, then we denote by u sub in parentheses 1 the minimum of all n uniform, by this the maximum of all of them, and in between you have the second minimum, and so on and so forth. If we have all this, then we can write, we can replace then this. So let us write that. Maybe it is better to repeat once, so that we don't mix things to each other. Okay. This equals zero. Okay, we are now ready to replace these guys, arrival times, with the ordered statistics of these IID uniform random variables. And this is not, we now face an unconditional probability. Okay, this is just equal. Unconditional probability involving ordered statistics of uniforms and yet some other independent random variables yk, right? Now, does anyone have any suggestions what should we should do from this point on? Now, first thing that comes to mind is in the first example, to replace this with ordinary use. Can we do that? And how can you justify that, yes? But what happens to this yk? So yk was added on uk. Now you change that u sub k with just the ordinary k. So they may or may not be the same. But does it really make a difference? Perhaps for the values, but not the distributions. Distributions are going to be the same. Namely, this random variable, okay, yes, and up to here, has the same probability distribution as the same sum, except that now this kth order statistic is being replaced with the kth random variable in that sequence. Since these two random variables, right, counts at the same distribution, then this probability is not gonna change if you replace the random variable itself with this one. Because the probabilities are determined by the distribution, it's not the realization of the random variable itself. Okay? For this reason, actually I have this probability equal the probability that the sum from 1 to n of the indicator event, the indicator random variable of the event uk plus yk is greater than or equal to t, right, equals 0. Okay. Why is that? Because, so look at, for example, u1 plus y1. And then compare this with u2 plus y2. Not u2 plus y2. u1 plus y1 and u2 plus y1. Or actually now we are looking at the joint distribution, right? We have to be careful. So you have u1 plus y1 and u2 plus y2. If, for example, the smaller of u1 and u2 is u1 and the larger of them is u2, right? That can be one case. But if it is just the other way around, then you happen to add y1 to u2 and y1 to u1. And then question becomes whether the joint distribution of these two are the same as the joint distribution of these two. If they are the same, then what I just wrote is correct. If not, then I must have made a mistake. So do they have the same probability distribution? They are, because these are independent random variables. What you do is you pick actually these two from the same distribution and these two from the same distribution. So what happens is, at any time, you ask somebody outside, give me a uniform random variable. They just pull give me a random variable coming from the same distribution as one of these random variable one. You get a one, you send them out. This is how you get this quantity. But you repeat the same experiment for this one as well. Because the numbers 1 and 2, the subscripts, are just for our convenience. Actually, you are repeating the same experiment over and over again. Right? Therefore, these are similar. These are similar. These are independent of each other and have the same distribution. They are as well. And actually, they are all the same. Or I should say, they all have the same statistical properties. Right? Therefore, here, I don't care either whether, since I am summing now, I don't really care in which order I actually match these u's with k, u's with y's, and then I sum. I really don't care about in either of these orderings. Now this probability is going to be the same as this one. And why should I care that this is the same as that one? Why should I care then? Now, is it now any easier to calculate this probability? What can you say about this probability? Well, what can you say about the distribution of this random variable first? Right? It's a messy random variable. You have ugly ones. You are summing them up. Right? You are counting. Right? Whenever you see indicator random variables, you always remember that you are counting. So, but, well, finite number of times, you look at, again, what an experiment is being conducted, right? For example, on the kth experiment, what is happening? You get a success if the sum is greater than t. You get a failure if it is not, right? And Are all these experiments, or do all these experiments look similar in some sense? Huh? So this is experiment for, well, there is experiment at time 1, u1 plus y1 greater than t. Then there is the experiment you conduct at time 2. You get 1 or 0 from here, you get 1 or 0 from here. It goes like that. What can you say about these experiments? Hande? Hande? What do they look like? 0 is 1, so therefore Bernoulli. Right? Are they independent? Results? You get 1 here, you get 0 there. Are they related? Yes. Yes, because the random variables are independent. So these are independent. This sum is independent of that. So if this is greater than t, that doesn't really contain any information about whether this is going to be greater than or equal to t or not. So these are actually independent Bernoulli experiments. Independent, if I can spell it out. And what does I know? Are they identically distributed? So their results are identically distributed. And in this case, they can take either value 1 or 0. So we are talking about the success probability. In fact, success, probability of getting success on one experiment, is that the same as the probability of getting a success on the other experiment? Yes, because u1 has the same distribution as u2, y1 has the same distribution as y2. Didn't they say that? Where did they write the question? We must see times spent by the customers independent, identically distributed. Right? And we said u1, u2 are what? Independent, identically distributed. So these are independent, these are independent, but these are independent, identically distributed, these are independent, identically distributed. They are independent, identically distributed, because arrival times have, time spent in the store have nothing to do with the arrival time. So these are what? The IID. Okay, let us write it one more time. These are IID Bernoulli random variables with success probability. What is that? Success probability. We used to denote it by P, but how can I calculate it here? What is the success probability? I've taken. When do I get a success? When does one of them become one? It is indicator random variable. It is one if this happens. Right? 1A is what? It is by definition 1, 0 if A happens. And 0 otherwise. So in this case, this has success probability the same as the probability that A happens, which is the same as what? Success probability in this case is the same as the probability that one of them happens, namely probability that u1 plus y1 is greater than or equal to t. Right? Huh? And therefore, what can you say about this? So this is like the review of the entire class. The sum of Bernoulli independent, identically distributed Bernoullis give us binomial. Very good. So then this has a binomial distribution. Right? Two parameters are needed. The first one tells us how many times and how many experiments have been conducted. And the second parameter tells us the success probability on each one of them, right? Okay. Now see, this probability is indeed easy to calculate because we know the distribution of the random variable, right? Here, well, in principle we know what it is, but it is difficult to calculate it because of this ordered statistics. It is difficult. Here, but we jumped over that difficulty by noticing that actually the order in which we sum all these indicators does not have any impact. In fact, probability remains the same if we just ignore the orders, and then the problem becomes easier to solve because this summation is the sum of IID binomial of even variables, therefore it has a binomial distribution. And then what is this probability? The binomial binomial random variable equals zero. How many success do I want?
Zero.
All of them should be failure. All of these n experiments should result in failure. Therefore, this equals what? In terms of success failure probability, 1 minus p to the power n. Right? Okay. Are you getting tired? Huh? So, okay. And then, in order to now complete the calculate or to find the complete answer, we have to calculate this p. Namely, we have to calculate this probability. So the success probability p equals the probability that u1 plus y1 is greater than or equal to t. What is this? This is, see, you may have actually played this game. Right? While this is happening, let's say u1 takes a value near du, and now you have to integrate from uniform between 0 and t. What was it? 0 and t, of course. T. But this joint distribution can be written as well, condition on that, and then you have to multiply by this probability. I use just base or the conditional expectation. Forget about this. It's just the definition of conditional expectation. So given u1 is near u, calculate the conditional probability that the sum is at least as large as t. And if this is true, then you know that this is u. And then this is the same as what? y1 is greater than t minus u, condition on that u1 was near u, times, we can write this one right away. So this is du, the length of the interval into which u1 falls, divided by the length of the entire interval, which is t. Right? And now, y1 is independent of u, therefore, at this stage, u1 no longer provide any more information about this. So we just erase this part. It is the same as unconditional probability. What is this? We were told that y1 has exponential distribution, right? Any one of them with this rate. And greater than this is e to the minus alpha times t minus u. Somehow. Okay. Okay. And so let me just continue from here. So this is the integral from 0 to capital T e to the minus lambda T minus u times du. There is 1 over T. We can take it out. What is this? Change u to t minus u, right? So you call this v if you like, but that will give, in fact, the same, not the same, but this. Okay? They are the same. Now, do you remember what this is? We don't take integrals here, right? It is forbidden. You're supposed to pay 62, yes, you divide. But let's try to remember like this, right? So now this is the density of an exponential, therefore this is the cumulative distribution function of an exponential at t, so it is e to the minus alpha t. And therefore this is 1 minus e to the minus alpha t divided by alpha times t. How come I got the same answer? Oh, anyway, success probability, right? Maybe therefore, that is that the reason? Right. Now, to the power n, then we should find this, we'll give this conditional probability. Right. Let us write it here. So we started, we worried about this, came up to this point and realized it is failure probability to the power n, and now we know what this is. It is given by this, namely 1 minus e to the minus alpha t divided by alpha t to the power 10. Okay. This is given by this. And, huh? Say it again.
Have I made it?
Ah, yes, of course. Now, we are fine with this, right? No problem. So we will take this, insert there. When we insert there, are we lucky to get the answer right away, or should we still have to work hard? So this equal now comes from here, right? So I have that. Now I have the sum. So the first term is conditional probability. We know equals 1 minus to the power n, and times now this one, right, which is lambda t to the power n divided by n factor times e to the minus lambda t. Does this go anywhere else? And does this simplify any further? So this doesn't depend n. So let's just take in the summation. Why do I, okay? Summation is supposed to start from zero. So this goes up, and I have a sum as n changes of 1. So this, there is this 1 minus e to the minus alpha t. Or why do I give a name? So this is clumsy to write. So it depends on t. Maybe this is like pt, p of t. Right? So p of t to the power n. But there is another term here which we raise to power n as well. So this is p t times lambda t to the power n, you divide by n factor. And this is too much. Does this simplify? Does this simplify further?
E to the x,
that's true. So this is your x, right? If you, and then this gives us the gives us e to the x. So we have this e function outside, and I have e to the whatever is sitting here, which is lambda times t times pt. So the result is e to the minus lambda t times 1 plus pt. Right? And pt being this, well, not plus, right? This could have actually caused me to lose lots of points in SSS. Right? Minus. Right? Minus, minus. Okay. Then 1 minus pt also has a nice thing. So was this pt? Yes. This was pt. Therefore, 1 minus pt equals what? No, pt was this. Okay? I made a mistake. So we can forget about this. 1 minus pt is just 1 minus e to the minus alpha t divided by alpha t. And therefore, the result becomes, sorry about this. Today I am unable to use the board. So this is now e to the minus lambda t times alpha t, and in the numerator I have 1 minus e to the minus lambda t, right? So this is the exponent. T cancel, you have e to the minus lambda times alpha times 1 minus e to the minus alpha t. So a fairly compact expression. What was this? This is the probability that at time t there are no customers in store. Okay? Alright. Of course, well, okay. The result is also nice, but in the meantime we learn how to manipulate such things. Are there any questions? So what was important? It is important to be able to think on conditioning on xt so that we can then use the fact that the conditional joint distribution of waiting times are the same as unconditional distribution of the ordered uniformly distributed random variables. And the second step was, actually the most important one, just to be able to observe that this summation on new random variable here, right, doesn't change. Well, it statistically doesn't change. Its statistical distribution, at least, doesn't change if you replace the ordered statistic with ordinary random variables. And the rest is what?
We again use our old knowledge of Bernoulli random variables, binomial random variables, and so on and so forth. Okay? Any questions?